तो वेलकम बैक डियर स्टूडेंट्स। सो वील बी स्टार्टिंग अ न्यू टॉपिक अबाउट स्ट्रक्चरल एंड नॉन स्ट्रक्चरल सेफ्टी। सो अगेन, सिंस ऑल ऑफ यू आर अ स्टूडेंट ऑफ मैकेनिकल इंजीनियरिंग एंड दिस इज एन ओपन इलेक्टिव, सो आई वोंट बी गोइंग इन टू द निटिग्रिटीज ऑफ द सिविल इंजीनियरिंग एस्पेक्ट्स विच आर द कोर कंसेप्ट रिलेटेड टू दिस स्ट्रक्चरल एंड नॉन स्ट्रक्चरल सेफ्टी। बट आई विल बी रिफ्रेशिंग एंड ऑल्सो गिविंग यू न्यू कंसेप्ट विद रिगार्ड्स टू स्ट्रक्चरल एंड नॉन स्ट्रक्चरल सेफ्टी मेजर्स, एंड योर अंडरस्टैंडिंग अबाउट इट विल बी एनहेंस्ड विद टूडेज लेक्चर। ओके, सो दीज मेजर्स और दीज प्रिकॉशंस इन टूडेज लेक्चर आई हैव फोकस्ड अपॉन द स्कूल्स। सो बेसिकली वी ऑल हैव बीन टू सम और द अदर स्कूल इन आर चाइल्डहुड, एंड राइट नाउ वी आर इन आर कॉलेज। सो आफ्टर दैट वॉट हैपन्स दैट वी हैव सीन मल्टीपल टाइम्स वेरियस प्रोसीजर्स हैपनिंग विद रिगार्ड्स टू डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट। सो योर एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन एनी ऑफ द सच असेसमेंट, इफ एनी, यू आर यू कैन यू मे फील फ्री टू शेयर इट विद अदर बैचमेट्स एज वेल एज विद मी वाया व्हाट्सएप और ईमेल। सो दिस विल बी एनहेंसिंग। सो वॉट काइंड ऑफ वर्क और वॉट काइंड ऑफ एक्सपीरियंस आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट, सो सच एज एनी ड्रिल्स दैट माइट हैव अकर्ड, एनी स्ट्रक्चरल कंस्ट्रक्शंस और नॉन स्ट्रक्चरल मेजर्स बींग टेकन एट योर स्कूल और एट आर इंस्टीट्यूट इन फ्रंट ऑफ यू और अंडर योर ऑब्जर्वेशन, विच हैज हेल्प्ड इन प्रिवेंशन द हजार्ड एंड दिस एज अ प्रिपेयर्डनेस मेजर। ओके, सो सम ऑफ द टर्मिनोलॉजीज, ऑल दो वी हैव डिस्कस दिस ऑल्सो अर्लियर। सो मिटिगेशन, वॉट वॉज मिटिगेशन? सो मिटिगेशन इज बेसिकली द लेसनिंग और लिमिटेशन ऑफ द एडवर्स इम्पैक्ट्स ऑफ हैजार्ड्स एंड रिलेटेड डिजास्टर्स। देन वी हैव स्ट्रक्चरल मिटिगेशन। सो एनी फिजिकल कंस्ट्रक्शन विच इज मेड टू रिड्यूस और अवॉइड पॉसिबल इम्पैक्ट्स ऑफ हजार्ड्स और एप्लीकेशन ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग टेक्निक्स टू अचीव एनी हजार्ड रेजिस्टेंस एंड रेजिलियंस इन स्ट्रक्चर्स और सिस्टम्स। ओके, फर्दर द स्ट्रक्चरल एलिमेंट्स ऑफ अ बिल्डिंग कैरी द वेट ऑफ द बिल्डिंग इटसेल्फ, द पीपल एंड द थिंग्स इनसाइड एंड द फोर्सेस ऑफ नेचर। ओके, सो दीज लोड बियरिंग एलिमेंट्स इंक्लूड द फ्रेम कॉलम बीम्स एंड इन मैसनरी और कंस्ट्रक्शन ऑल्सो द शियर वॉल। सो वॉट इज अ शियर वॉल? दिस इज अ न्यू टर्म हियर। सो ओवरऑल टू समराइज अबाउट स्ट्रक्चरल मिटिगेशन, फर्स्टली आई विल से दैट यू जस्ट नीड टू रिमेंबर दैट एनी ऑफ द फिजिकल कंस्ट्रक्शन दैट हैज बीन मेड टू रिड्यूस और मिनिमाइज द इम्पैक्ट्स और द पॉसिबल इम्पैक्ट्स ऑफ एनी ऑफ द हजार्ड्स और ऑन एनी ऑफ द डिजास्टर्स। फॉर वेरी स्मॉल एग्जाम्पल, वी कंस्ट्रक्ट और वी पुट अ लॉक इन आर होम्स एंड वी जनरली क्लोज द लॉक्स ड्यूरिंग द नाइट टाइम वाइल वी स्लीप। वाई डू वी डू दैट? टू प्रिवेंट वन ऑफ द मैन मेड डिजास्टर्स विच इज नोन एज थेफ्ट। सो दिस इज अ स्ट्रक्चरल मिटिगेशन। ओके, एंड फर्दर इफ यू आर कंस्ट्रक्टिंग एनी टिपिकल थिंग विच इज हेल्पिंग यू इन हजार्ड मैनेजमेंट, सो दैट इज फर्दर अ पार्ट ऑफ स्ट्रक्चरल मिटिगेशन। ओके, नाउ वॉट इज अ शेयर वॉल? सो शेयर वॉल इज बेसिकली कंस्ट्रक्टेड मोस्टली इन सम हाई राइज बिल्डिंग्स एनी वेयर बिटवीन ग्राउंड ग्राउंड फ्लोर प्लस फोर और ग्राउंड फ्लोर प्लस 10, 12 और अदर्स मल्टी हाई राइज बिल्डिंग्स मल्टी फ्लोर्स। सो अ शेयर वॉल इज अ टिपिकल एंड स्पेशली कंस्ट्रक्टेड स्ट्रक्चरल एलिमेंट दैट प्लेज अ वाइटल रोल इन मिनिमाइजिंग द इम्पैक्ट ऑफ द अर्थक्वेक वेव्स ऑन द एंटायर बिल्डिंग। एज अ स्टूडेंट ऑफ seismic engineering and civil engineering, the students learn the design concepts as well, what are the standard procedures, where these shear walls must be placed in a high-rise building, and what are the advantages, disadvantages and others. So we are not going into much of the detail, but my focus is to cover the entire concept with regards to structural mitigation. So moving on ahead, so some of the components of structural mitigation include resistance construction. So whatever buildings or infrastructure you are constructing, including roads, highways, waterways or anything, offshores, so these constructions should be such that they firstly adhere all the safety norms provided by the government, the standard codes, the values they have followed, such as building codes and other regulatory measures. The building or infrastructure, whatever there is, it should be resistant enough. For example, if there is an earthquake prone area, so the building should be resistant to minimize the impacts of earthquake. If that particular area undergoes cyclones frequently, so the wind loads or the heavy impact caused by the cyclone should be considered while construction of these resistant constructions of any infrastructure. So that will further prevent this hazard. Next we have relocation. So if it is found that particular building is in a very high hazard prone area, so generally it is done that the people and the building itself is relocated to some other part. Then we have structural modification. So sometimes there is a concept known as structural retrofitting. So what does retrofitting mean? So retrofitting is reinforcing or re-strengthening some particular thing. So in case of structures, especially when we talk about the concrete made structures, so they have a definite life. It is not like that they have an infinite life. So with the time, the reinforcement, that is a steel reinforcement, it gets corroded. The structure loses its strength due to various different loads from time to time over the years. So let us say there is a building which is 40 to 50 years old, or maybe let us say 30 years old. So firstly, assessments are done, structural assessments are done. There are multiple procedures for that, multiple methods available for that. So it is assessed that what is the condition of the building presently. Next, after assessing the structural strength, the structural engineers, they provide measures to modify the building. Okay, the modification should be such that these buildings, they adhere the codes, they get the required and necessary strength. Okay, so structural retrofitting is one of the method to again re-strengthen an old building or any of the building which has faced any of the damage, such as fire damage, earthquake or cyclonic damage. Next we have physical modification. So let us say there is a construction, but somehow it has not followed the procedures or the relevant required codes, or maybe suddenly there is a presence of some or the other kind of earthquake or the disaster. So what will happen? The building in itself will not be able to resist it, safeguard itself and the people inside. So what is done? The physical modification for that particular structure is done. Okay. Then we have lintel beam, columns, masonry walls, plinth beam, foundation and corrosion. I have discussed about corrosion and rest of these written five structural elements. Why they have been mentioned here is because
these are some of the key elements which we observe that in case of any of the disasters or any of the assessment procedures, it is found that these are some of the key elements which are found to lose strength very quickly, and again they are also highly prone to various loadings, dynamic loadings of earthquakes and other things. So to safeguard the building, these particular elements should be designed well enough, and not only just designed, during the construction process proper measures should be taken to proper curing is done, the concrete placement is optimized, proper vibrations have been provided, there is no error in placing the concrete. So multiple things need to be checked by the site engineers. This image will depict the key difference between structural and non-structural measures to be taken. So basically, structural measures, they include the construction of any of the physical quantity or physical infrastructural or structural element, such as an additional column or maybe a shear wall or maybe a different structure in itself. So any of the procedures that include the construction of any of the structural element or a structure in whole is known as structural measure, and any of the measures taken for any of the mitigation procedures for any of the hazard which does not include any of the construction procedures, these are termed as non-structural. Okay, so these are non-structural measures. Again, I'll repeat that non-structural measures are those which do not undergo any of the structural changes, modification, or any new construction. Then we have some of the structural mitigation measures. So geographical area of the building construction, this is one of the very prominent reasons for any of the procedures to be opted. So coastal areas will have a different condition, desert areas will have a different, river bank, flood prone areas, rural, urban, and again areas nearing to industrial areas and hazardous industries. So again, it should be noted that once and again that multiple times I have been mentioning about earthquakes or floods, because mostly the codal provisions or the, as a civil engineer, we deal with providing strength in terms of that loading only. But the disasters are not just limited to earthquake and floods. The disasters may be of any of the kind. Disasters, firstly, natural and man-made, we have discussed multiple disasters by now. So any of these disasters and further these location of this geographic area of those buildings, they heavily affect the particular zones or the particular buildings. Next is earthquake zoning of building construction. So earthquake zoning is basically, as we discussed in our topic of earthquake, that basically we discussed that our nation has been divided into four categories. Okay, so these four categories are in zone 2, zone 3, zone 4 and zone 5. So whenever we are constructing a building, so it should be taken care of that the zonation has been taken care of, and the earthquakes and all these loads have been considered while taking in mind about the zonations, okay, about the various earthquake zones. Next we have the types of structures. So there are different types of structures, such as frame structures, these are mostly used in bridges. Then there are load bearing structures or maybe wooden structures. Okay, so type of structure will again affect the structural mitigation measures to be followed. Then the soil pattern, whether the soil is rocky or sandy. If the soil is sandy, then the earthquake waves
will be affecting in a different way. If the soil is rocky, if the soil is clayey, then the effects will be different for different types of disasters. Then the things that affect are roofing pattern, age of the building, the retrofitting of the building. Also, if the whether the building is multi-story, whether the fire safety and other things are installed or not, whether the building is having insurance. So this might be a new concept for all of you, but building insurance has been taking a rise ever since. So as we all get life insurance, the vehicle insurance, nowadays there is also a provision of getting building insurance. So in case of disasters, the companies will provide you the allotted funds. So all these things taken and considered, they affect our decision making with regards to structural mitigation measures. Okay. Next, as per the some of the new norms for some particular buildings, there is a provision for compulsory earthquake insurance. Okay. So you can have a detail by the link that is given below. Okay. Next, some of the terminologies with regards to non-structural mitigation. So as I mentioned above, that any measure which is not involving physical construction that uses knowledge, practice or agreement to reduce risks and impact in particular through policies and laws, public awareness raising, training and education. So these are some of the non-structural mitigation. Then the non-structural elements of a building do not carry the weight of the building and include windows, doors, stairs, partition walls, pipes and ducts. So they include what are the building contents. Now what are these building contents? So building contents are the things that users bring with them, such as furniture, appliances, coolers, water tanks, etc. Now in other words, non-structural elements are those which are either attached to building or kept in building. Okay. So this is also one of the key difference between structural and non-structural mitigation definitions. Now from here I will be taking the example of a typical school. Okay. So within the school building, the furniture and the fixtures, what is the placement, then what are the various equipments, electrical, electronic, gaming, utensils, where they are placed, electrical wirings, whether they are open, whether they are pipe fitted, whether they are putty fitted, then the showcases, the frames, the notice boards, how the study materials are placed, such as demonstration toys, books, charts, then how are the storage cabinets placed, such as whether they are in the wall or outside the wall. Now you might find it interesting and new, but all of these things highly affect whatever happens during the earthquake and the damage caused, because these are the most vulnerable things that will start to fall or that will try to gain as much as momentum with the event of any earthquake or any of the calamity. Okay, so placement of all these things highly affect the hazard levels for that particular building. Also, display cupboards, almaries, and mass evacuation dimensions for halls and stairways in public building. Then smoke in the hallway, how it is to be removed and all. Now within the school building, you must have observed, even in an institute, that the doors and windows, they open inwards. Then glass panes, what is the movement? They move outwards. Then tall bookcases or cabinets which are not properly secured to the wall, they are vulnerable again. Then areas where flammable liquids are stored, such as science labs, chemistry labs. Then we have this fire extinguisher placement, then other movable or falling blocking hazards. So moving on ahead, some of the hazards which might be there outside a school building include high tension lines or power lines, then trees, parapets. Parapets are structural elements. I can give you a simple example of chhajja, as we say in Hindi. Then we have roof tiles, chimneys, glass, etc. Then the roots that passed concrete walls. Then we have rivers, sea coast, main roads, marketplaces, inflammable goods, open wells, fencing, ramp, grab bars, etc. So again, take 10 seconds and again have a look regarding the same. So I hope you have read it once. Now let us move ahead. So risk identification of NSM. So earthquakes are a risk that we accept by living in an earthquake region. Okay, we face many other risks in our life as well as we take precautions to reduce our losses from them. Then NSM is a reasonable precaution against earthquake risks from non-structural elements of buildings. So to decide what these non-structural measures is necessary, you need to identify what risks exist in your home, in your school, at your workplace and other public buildings. Now this risk varies from situation to situation. Okay, it is important to evaluate each situation individually. So we can prevent serious injuries, deaths. We can prevent damages to the belongings. Okay, now let us take some examples. So as you can see, this is a typical example of a classroom. The placement of these equipments, musical instruments and other boxes, these are in such a position that in case of an event of earthquake or any of the calamity, these might fall directly on these innocent childs. So again, if there is a very high amount of space constraint, these should be tied with the wall, and never, to say the least, that first in the first direction, that these all these things should not be present in a classroom, especially where the children's of a very young age are present. Then this is example of a poorly managed chemistry lab. So as you can see, the acids, the various chemicals, the various glassware, they all have been placed openly. And in case of any event where the building seems to be collapsing or any of the calamities happening, so these will be just the most vulnerable things, and this room will be the most disastrous room out of all. So it should be taken care of. Now in the households and offices, now see in the left image, you can see that a television has been placed upon a basic cylinder. So in case again of an event of calamity, there might be possibility that there is a child roaming around there, or you might be running out there. So it might be possible that television might fall, isn't it? Then on the right, we see a very poor cable management, where the power cables are just running openly everywhere, and the main power cable is coming from the top. So it is again very inefficient way of cable management. Now again, you can see the placement and the condition. So whether it doesn't matter that whether you have placed a fan, but frequent measures or frequently it should be checked whether these fans are structurally stable, whether they will fall or not, or what is their present condition, because it might affect lives of these children very heavily in case it falls. Now at some of the other schools, these images were taken where the electrical appliances were simply hanging without not much support from the roof. So this is again a very bad procedure. Then again, you can see in the left a poor cable management, and then again on the right you can see that there is a pump as well, and there is an open well. So there is a high probability that someone might fall there. So a shade should be definitely there. Then again, as you can see, though, in all of these images that these all items are providing blockages, they are providing or increasing the hazard in case of any of the calamities. So such things should be observed as a student of disaster management from now on. So from today onwards, all of you should take care and observe things whether they are placed correctly or not. I am not saying that earthquake might occur today or tomorrow, but we don't know when the earthquake might occur. It might be possible that during the time I am recording this lecture, the earthquake might happen. So what are my preventive measures that I have taken? Once we lose a life, there are hardly any excuses to make. So it's better to prevent than later than ever, okay? Now further, this is also an example of a classroom where a display board has been placed, and you can see there are some cutleries and some other things that are placed, and in case of any of the earthquake event, the first items to fall will not be the building but will be these movable items, and it will be causing injuries to all these young children. Then unanchored furniture. So these are some of the habits that most of the households even follow, that all the furniture, all the belongings are just unanchored. That means they are not tied up or anything. So it might be possible that these things start falling, and if there is a glassware or any metallic things, that it might affect or it might block your way to escape. Then avoid any heavy storage items on shelves. As you can see, this is again a typical this is an ongoing drill, seems like, where the earthquake drill is happening. So these heavy items might fall at any time. Then again, unanchored sound equipment. Again, these are also very highly hazard making things. Okay, now impact of this school and NSRM. So as a team, what we can do, we can visit the nearby schools and create awareness about the non-structural mitigation. Then reduce loss of life, protect school equipments and educational materials. By reducing the potential for injuries and fatalities. Then reduced fear and increased attendance ratio of the students will be observed. Increase in the community's ability to keep the school open in case of disaster will be there. Helping to maintain safe and clear exit ways. Saving manpower, building response capacities. Then children, what they learn in school will be the same that they will implement at home. So today we have learned about non-structural mitigation measures. So definitely I expect that many of you will now try to observe things and try to anchor the loose items. Then further, some of the mitigation measures include relocate of furnishing and contents, then securing non-structural building elements and furnishing, then actions for off-site non-structural hazard, then asking for consultation engineers and maintenance personnel together for solution. Then what is required is behavioral changes among users, which is very vital and indispensable that users develop the culture of safety, like use of dustbin to avoid water blocking, logging, or discipline when moving in a mass. Okay, now other mitigation measures include identify which mitigation activities will reduce the risk of damage and injury the most, then to determine which activities can be accomplished at little or no cost. Look up, look around, look down, look the videos and all. Okay, so how to do non-structural mitigation. So these are again some of the things I will be sharing these presentations with you. You might see that how anchorage can be done. A very simple example of door stopper, window stopper, then polyester films. So all of these basic things, they will heavily affect the non-structural measures. Now corridor should be clear. Heavy items should not be placed in such a way. Heavy items should be placed below, lighter items should be placed above. Okay,
Further, there are further some examples. Again, basically to prevent any of the these vulnerable non-structural items from falling off. So again, as you can see, this almira is placed directly near the wall. So in case of a collapse of this wall, this almira might also fall. Or it might also be possible that almira might fall earlier. So anchorage has been done in the right corner image. You can see right bottom image. Okay. So let us we'll see these sessions. You can see in the presentation what are various measures, anchorage provisions that have been taken. Even the gas cylinders, if possible, you should anchor them. You should not let them wander around, or at least place them in a closed cabinet. So it will be helpful. Placement of geysers. Geysers should be anchored. Connection should be flexible. Okay. So that's all for today's session. So today, to revise, we learned about various structural and non-structural mitigation measures, and we took example of a particular school in which the non-structural elements were not very well managed. I will try to bring about some of the new topics as well with regards to structural measures, and further we'll be moving on to cover the other topics as well. Okay, so that's all for today's session. See you in the next one. Okay, thank you.